Welcome to the Mt Gale Missionary Baptist Church, number 8 Benin Drive, Conway, Arkansas, where Reverend Forrest Cooper is the pastor.
These are your announcements.
Join us each Sunday morning at 11 a.m. in the Family Life Center or online on YouTube and Facebook.
Singing will be limited to 60 social distancing seats. Pre-registrations will be required each week.
Thank you for joining us for our in-person services and our virtual services each Sunday morning at 11 a.m. on YouTube and Facebook. Be blessed as we prepare for the worship experience on today.
Do anything but fail. I trust him in his word. There's nothing my God cannot do. the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. We come to worship you. Tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come glory, God, is what our hearts want.
God. Let us become more aware of His presence. We truly understand how good He is. How much He's already kept us from just today. Danger seen and unseen. Things that He's brought us through and gave us our right mind. Woke us up this morning. Food on the table, clothes on our backs. Let's be more aware of His presence in our lives. Happy to get a phone call this morning. God has been good to some of us today. When we begin to be aware of how God is moving at all times, in every situation, in every circumstance, we'll give Him some praise. We'll lift His holy name up. It's good to be in His presence. The Bible says when two or three are gathered in His name, there He will be in the midst.
Yeah.
Jesus is in the midst today. And when God shows up, whatever it is that's on your table, whatever you want, whatever you desire, what's on your heart, whatever issues you're dealing with, because God is in the mix, you have the opportunity to turn it over to Him today. Don't leave this place the same way you came. Don't leave here with the same burden that you showed up with. Allow God and allow the Holy Spirit to do its work. That's what we've been for. To allow the Holy Spirit to do what it comes to do. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank You for this day. We thank You just allowing us together one more time, Lord God. One more time to be in Your presence. One more time to sing praises, Lord God. One more opportunity to thank You for the things that You've done in our lives, Lord God. Lord God, if You don't do anything else from us, You've already done enough for Lord God. Lord God, You've watched over us. You've kept us. Lord God, You've fed us. You've shepherded us. You've sheltered us from storms. We say thank You for that today, Lord God. Lord God, we just thank You for the opportunity to be in Your midst today. Thank You for the fellowship amongst brothers today, Lord God. Thank You for the word that's going to go forth today, Lord God. Lord God, thank You that You give us our health and our strength today, Lord God. Lord God, we pray right now for all those that are sick and shut in today, Lord God. All those that are afflicted with any manner of sickness, we pray right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Have Your way, Lord God. We pray for healing, Lord God. We pray for comfort, Lord God. Lord God, we pray right now in the midst of this pandemic, Lord God. Continue to move us in the right direction, Lord God. Lord God, help us to see brighter days ahead, Lord God. Lord God, we pray for all those that are suffering today around this world, Lord God. Those that were suffering before a pandemic and still suffer now, Lord God. We pray over poverty right now, Lord God. Lord God, we pray for those that are struggling with financial issues, Lord God. Lord God, those that are struggling with emotional issues today, Lord God. Lord God, we know that just because there was a pandemic, other problems didn't stop, Lord God. But Lord God, we pray right now to You that whatever is in this place today, Lord God, that needs to be lifted, whatever burden that needs to be lifted, whatever chain that needs to be broken, Lord God, whoever it is that needs to be set free, we pray that You do it in the name of Jesus today, Lord God. We stand on Your word, Lord God. We stand on Your power, Lord God. Not by my might, Lord God, but by Your power, Lord God. Let Your will be done in this place today, Lord God. Lord God, we pray for our pastor as he's traveling, Lord God. We pray that You give him safe travels, Lord God. Lord God, we pray that You give him strength, Lord God, that You touch him from the top of his head to the sole of his feet. Anoint him, Lord God, with Your spirit and Your presence, Lord God. And Lord God, we pray for this choir. We pray for the praise team. We pray for the musicians. We pray for the deacons. We pray for every ministry here today, Lord God. Help them, Lord God, to do Your will, Lord God. Give them vision, Lord God. Give them insight, Lord God. Lord God, we just pray right now today that whatever's keeping us from worshiping You in spirit and in truth, that You bind it in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Whatever's hindering Your will to be done, Lord God, we bind it in the name of Jesus right now, Lord God. You gave us that power in Your word, Lord God. So we bind whatever it is that's holding back, Lord God. Let us just be free to worship You in spirit and in truth, Lord God. Have Your way in the service. Have Your way today, Lord God, and let Your word go forth. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Kings chapter 17, verses 15 and 16. 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 15 and 16. She went away and did as Elijah had told her. So there was food every day for Elijah and for the woman and her family. For the jar of flour was not used up, and the jug of oil did not run dry, in keeping with the word of the Lord spoken by Elijah. I want to talk about for just a few minutes living by your giving. Living by your giving. God bless you. It's great to see everyone on today. I've already went one round this morning at my home church and broke a few laws getting there. My sister Cooper been in prayer meeting the whole while. She praying, Deacon Dawes. She praying hard and trying to tell me how to drive. After about 12 tickets, I ought to know how to drive by now. That was in a 5-year span, 12 tickets, 79 to 84. They took my license. But by the grace of God, we made it to all, to Sister Cooper, to all of us, Sister Pickett, to all of our ministers, Reverend Pickett, Reverend Gilmore, who are on apology. We had some change up, mix up, and all that. You're supposed to have been preaching. Amen. And so we thank you for your commitment as well. Amen. You'll definitely be back on the block, so keep your iron sharp. Amen. Amen. I was trying to pray to God. I don't take preaching lightness. And I know that this pandemic, this time period of life, has caught a lot of us in some stressful and strainful situations. And I was shocked because I was trying to prepare this message and looking at some old messages and trying to say, well, God, what do you want me to say? So I'm going to give you your miracle on the front end and we'll go on with the word. The miracle is not that you did not get your blessing. The miracle is that you made it on a little bit. Y'all don't know when to shout. The miracle is not that your ship didn't come in. The miracle is that you kept floating anyway. See, many times we think God ought to bless, heal, deliver, make a way, open doors, and everything in our favor. But sometimes God gets more glory from our life when we go through stuff. And then we have a testimony of how he brought us through. Deacon Moore, you know what I'm talking about. We have a testimony of how God kept us even in situations. The ambassador of God is sent to the believer during a time of famine in her life. I need to communicate some crucial and critical concepts on how to function in a famine. Ambassadors, representatives, preachers, teachers, parents, those in your life whom God has designated to say something to you to help you get through your life. It's not always the pastor. It should be your pastor say something, but there ought to be some other folk in your life that can speak value, speak principle, speak something about how to get through what you're going through. I say that openly because all of us are going through something. My something may not be your something. My financial crisis may not be your financial crisis. Your medical crisis may not be my medical crisis. Your domestic disturbance may not be mine. But all of us are experiencing something. And sometimes you feel like this widow woman at Zarephath. You feel like you're in a famine all by yourself. Got news for you. Famine takes in more than just you. need to warn the body of Christ that famines of life are real. The famines, the atmosphere during the famine, the assessment of whose fault for the famine. That's what was going on. It was dry everywhere. It was dry. And there was an argument going on between Ahab and Elijah. Ahab says, Elijah, you the problem. Elijah tells Ahab, you the problem. Y'all missed that. We've been pointing fingers all over, right? Who's the problem? Democrats, Republican, 45, his cabinet, or who's the problem with this national crisis? Then we got ships on the western shore that can't come in and dock because they don't have enough workers. And whose fault is it that the ship's over there? And what about the tariffs and the taxes that they put on the ships? And now they say that since you're going to tariff and tax us, we're not really going to worry about America. We're going to take care of the rest of the world. Y'all with me? So we're all wondering who's the problem for our family. Some of you blaming your parents. Some of you blaming your kids. I'd have some money if I didn't have these kids. Y'all ever say that? I could have bought me a bass boat and bought me a side-by-side and all that, but I'm busy putting children through college and running back to Ford. Kids saying, I could have had a better life if you'd have saved money right, Daddy. If you spent your money wisely and had budgets and all that, I could have went to college on your money instead of having to get loans. I'll holler one time if you hear me. We all can find somebody to blame. It wasn't just a famine in the land. It's a famine principle that applies to all of life. The assessment of the famine. But the problem I have with it is, Brother Adrian, is the assignment of the ambassador. He has to go to the widow woman's house. Now watch this. Holler when you hear me. He's already experienced the favor of God. He's been at the brook Cherith. Fed by ravens. One old preacher said one was a butcher and the other was a baker. They showed up every day with bread and meat at the brook Chilo. But what do you do when your brook dries up? Any of you ever been in that situation where a honey hole you had some money in the honey hole and you had some finances stashed away? And I don't call it a honey hole. I call mine a mad money box. To all the brothers, y'all catch me on this, all the brothers. It's a box that I put a little change in every chance I get so that when stuff go to getting tough, I look in that box and it keep me from getting mad. Y'all going to catch that on the way home. Y'all going to catch that. Put you some money in your mad money box and make sure that when times get tough and before you get mad, you look in that box, you're going to say, it's going to be all right. Amen. And this is not on the paper I'm giving more, but this is just for good measure. All of us need to handle our finances well. Because one of these days, this electronic system going to shut down. You can have good money in the bank, but if all you got is a plastic card. Did y'all hear me? A good amen ought to go right there. All I'm trying to tell you is not actually how to handle your doing, but be wise. Be wise and be studious. I know some folk, and I won't call their name, but they won't waste their money. And if you would listen to them, they won't allow you to waste your money. You need some people like that in your life. The assignment of the ambassador is to show up at a woman's house, the ability of God to honor those who speak for him. Always remember when you're an ambassador of God, male or female, when you are an ambassador for God, when you speak what God has told you, God will cover you. I'm going to say it one more time. When you speak what God has told you, make sure that it's from God. God will cover you. The aim of God is to always honor his word. Famines test the realness and the resilience of your faith. diamonds test the realness and the resist. You are, I'll say this to you, got to have some bounce back in you. You got to have some bounce back. You don't let everything knock you down and stay down. It's all right to get knocked down, but get back up. Real quick, you remember that little toy they had? Brother Carlos said that you had it, you could stand it up, and no matter how you would knock it down, it would bounce back up. You could kick it, it would bounce back up. You could run through the house, your children would run through the house and give it a big karate kick and knock it down, it bounced back up. Some of you have been kicked and beaten by life, but you keep getting up. When folk look at you and all of a sudden say, you ought to be down for the count. And here you come, getting back up. That's why the Paul wrote, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. You get up. Because God is covering your life. This water famine, 3.5 years of drought. 3.5 years of no rain. 3.5 years of no dew. You ever understand? There was an old man in my hometown that would get up every morning before going to work. And rather than him using well water to keep his car clean, he would always use the dew off the car. If you left your car outside at night, your dew fell on it, you got to get up early in the morning, just take him a rag and use the dew. Like the dew in the morning, gently rest. But in this drought, there was not even any dew. Can you imagine what your life would be like with no dew and no rain? Now, the dew, D-E-W, is not as well comprehended by the young generation as it is by those of us with little gray hair. But those of us with gray hair, we know what it's like to have to work the fields. We need rain. We need water. We need resources. We need some nourishment and vitamins for the ground. And nowadays, because you have seedless grape, seedless watermelon, all that stuff, powdered milk, so now they want a seedless blessing. That's enough to go home on right there. We want God to do something for us, and we don't want to plan anything. We don't want to do anything. We don't want to give any extra. But I'm determined to believe that when you follow God's guide in Genesis, he said every seed has in itself its own substance. So whatever seed you plant is coming up again. That's not just for the soil. That's even for your soul. That's for life. Whatever seed you plant is coming up again. And if you have a problem with what you're reaping, you ought to change your sowing. Proclamation is indicative of the human experience, verse 12. A declaration of hopelessness. A famine can be taxing and draining on your faith. I'm going to say this, and a lot of y'all are not going to be honest. In fact, I don't even want you to raise your hand. This is just a rhetorical question. Has anybody ever thought within themselves, I need to just give up? Go back to the old way of living? You ever thought, I'm just going to throw in my hand, throw in the towel, and this is a record court. Don't nobody ask. Don't nobody nod. Don't look left. Don't look right. I don't want to identify anybody. I'm just trying to help you. A famine will test you. A famine will squeeze, and it will try to squeeze all of your faith out of you. To the point that you say, I was better off when I was hanging out with in the hood. I was better off when I was slinging. Y'all know what I'm talking about. I was better off when I was rolling with the boys. But thank God them old saints said, you can't make me doubt him. Because I know too much about him. He brought me too far. Verse 13 and 14. The prerequisite that requires faith. Elijah said to her, first of all, don't be afraid. Go home and do as you have said, but first make a cake of bread for me from what you have and bring it to me. Then make concept, because I thought it was kind of unwise for a person to be trying to ask of a widow and her son for something. But God showed me something bigger. If you're going to take care of the widow, you got to have someone to help take care of the widow. Y'all missed that. If you're going to take care of the widow and her son, someone has to take the lead. And sometimes God wants you to give to that individual or that entity that's going to help take care of you. I'm just going to be honest about it. You need God to get you through this, right? You in a famine? You in a dire strait? You're between a rock and a hard place? You at the end of your rope? You need somebody to get you through it, right? And so we all choose that God's going to be the one to get us through it, right? So if the one that's going to get you through it sent you somebody to help you get through it, don't you think you need to take care of that one? Take care. And now, the testimony is in Elijah's statement, verse 14. But this is what the Lord said, the Lord God of Israel says, the jar of flour will not be used up, and the jug of oil will not run dry until the day the Lord gives rain on the land. That's enough to go home right there. Elijah says, God said, the Lord says to Israel, that he says, if you do this, the oil won't run out, and the meal won't run out. Y'all so quiet on me this morning. It might not run over, but it won't run out. You might not get a million, but I still let you get a check every week. You might not get a new car, but I still let that old one get you to and fro. You might not have full health, but I still let you get up every morning and breathe and thank God that some folk are much worse off than I am. He said, some of it, he said, if you do what God says, the oil won't run out and the meal won't run out. He said, I'm going to make sure that it's a continuous, constant, consecutive flow in your life. I'm from the country, Dick Dosh, and I know there's a difference between a river or a creek and a pond. Y'all with me? Brother Fletcher, there's a difference between a creek and a pond. Brother Greg, a pond will have water in it, but there's no circulation. And the water gets stale and dry and murky and stinky. Can I get a witness? But if you got your little old creek, a little river, a little flow, you constantly have some flowing, fresh water. I'd rather have a creek any day than a pond. Because God says it won't be much, but it'd be enough to flow to you every day. 1st of all, this the observation that they're in a famine is the obedience that works in a famine. But the old obedience really works on your faith. A display of obedience and trust is what God is looking for in your life. This is how to live a word-based life. Put God first, and everything else will fall into place. Y'all hear me? That's for everybody. If you put God first, if you make God the center, if you make God numero uno, number one, everything else will have its proper place. Everything else in your life ought to be hidden for second seat. Because you know who got number one. Somebody y'all should have heard it. Everything else in your life ought to be shooting for second seed. Y'all remember when you played basketball or played whatever your sport, you'd always brag and tell your team, y'all going to be second. We know who got number one. Y'all be saying way about all them other small gods, them other worldly figures, that trinkets of gold and jewel. I know who got second place over there. Y'all fighting over it. But number one belongs to God. He tells her to do this. the proposal, the predicament, the perception. But really, Elijah can say it because God's already proven himself to me. Y'all missed it. You got to do a history. Elijah says to her, if you will trust God now, let me tell you the reason you ought to trust him is because of what he done for me back then. He said, when the famine started, God positioned me in a place where he could take care of me every day. Is there anybody here God positioned you? You think you in a good spot? You didn't get there because you this small. You didn't get there because you crossed all your T's and dotted all of your I's. But God positioned you in a place in your life because he knew a famine was coming. And he said, I need to rescue Mt Gale members, Pastor Cooper, the deacons, the muses, everybody. I need to put them in a spot. Better prove. Now, I ought to be able to get a line here and just pass the mic. And everybody tell me the spot they were in and God proved himself. The spot you were in and God, you were by a brook and God took care of you when everything else around you was going haywire. God took care of you when everything around, watch this, when folk around you were depressed over the family. I preached in my home church this morning. That's why I'm running late. But one of the things I said, I'm going to make it plain and clear. There's too many depressed Christians in the body of Christ. Hold your head up. Believe that God is able. Believe that God can do it. You ought to shout until you believe it yourself. Don't try to make me believe it. Shout until you believe God can do something. The reason I say that, the woman said to Elijah, all I have is little meal and little oil. Y'all want to hear this. I'm going to make me and my son a cake, eat it, and die. Is that not in text? If that's not a depressed spirit, you eating your last meal. Oh, Lord, help me, Holy Ghost. You're about to eat your last meal. You've already declared you're going to die. And the mouthpiece that's going to deliver you and direct you is standing in front of you. Holy Ghost, help me. Oh, thank you, Holy Ghost. I missed that one. Death and giving up. Death is not in your hand anyway. You did not give yourself life. You don't have a right to take your life. You don't even have a right to give up on the life that you've been given. Somehow, Holy Ghost, help me. One of the problems it was in the text is the woman was alone. You get alone, you go talking to yourself. You talk yourself out of some stuff. You talk yourself into some stuff. You'll talk, you'll say, huh? And you'll mess around and have a three-way conversation. Me, myself, and I. Can't none of you come up with the same answer. I'm just trying to help somebody out. Depression will cause you to talk to yourself when you ought to talk to God or find you a person. See, I watch this. I pray for a lot of people. I pray for a lot of people. Not just your pastor. You need to have some members in your family. Are members in the body of Christ. You need you some prayer warriors. Some folk. I remember one time when I had something going on real serious, and I thank God I had some prayer warriors in Conway. I had some prayer warriors in Prattsville. I had some prayer warriors in Pine Bluff. I had some prayer warriors in Ball Knob. I was broke down and crying. I couldn't talk. I just texted them all and said, y'all need to start praying. See, I don't even know what's going on in your life. That ain't my business. Just tell me you want me praying for you and I got you covered. The picture proof is that the meal bag never run out. The predicament of the famine, it was all over the land. The proposal of the mouthpiece of God is to facilitate you through a process that will help you get through what you're going through. and he says, go and make it, that's one. Make me some first, that's two. Make you and your son and your, and my text says, your family some, that's three. And then your meal barrel will not run out, nor your crews of all. Y'all know what happened. Y'all, he says, if you do what, like God says, do it. I know you're intelligent, but if you do it like God says, do it. I know you got good sense, you got degrees on the wall, but if you just, sometimes you need to forget about what you know and do it like God says, do it. That's what Paul says. He says, I count it all loss because I want to know Christ. He said, Paul says, forgetting those things which are behind me, I press forward to the mark. What did Paul forget? Paul says, I'm born from the raw stock. I was baptized on the eighth day, circumcised on the eighth day. I went to school at the best school. I was taught by the best teachers. Paul said, I am somebody. According to society's point of view, I am somebody. But Paul said, I count it all lost. I count it as dung. I throw it all in rubbish because I want to know Christ. I want to know the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering. I want to be like Jesus. And if you decide you're going to do it God's way, if you decide you're going to follow God's program, follow God's plan, God made it promise. If you do it God's way, he says the oil won't run out. He says the meal barrel won't run out. He says in Matthew, if he takes care of the lilies of the field, if he takes care of the fowls of the air, he'll do that for them. You know he's going to take care of you. The reason why I know he's going to take care of me is because what is man that thou art mindful of him? And the son of man that thou visit him? I've made him a little lower than the angels, but I've crowned him with glory and honor. He says that man is made after his own image. And when God makes something after his own image, he promised to take care of it. He gave so much for it. He promised to take care of man because he loved man so much that he gave his only begotten son, that he died for the man. He died to take care of you. He died to give you a new beginning. He died to get you through a famine. He died. Can I get a witness? He died to take care of your soul, but he also sits on the throne to take care of your survival. The same God that was on the mountain, on Calvary Mountain, he got the same principle over this woman's life. He told that the oil won't run out and the meal won't run out. You ought to thank God that you made it on a little bit. You ought to thank God that you made it on a one-week check. You ought to thank God that you made it on unemployment. You ought to thank God that you made it with nothing coming in. You ought to thank God. I declare you ought to wave your hand. You ought to lift up your voice and say you didn't have to do it, but you did. And I thank you. You didn't have to save me, but you did. And I thank you. I'm living by my giving. I'm going to give to God because he gave all for me. I'm going to give to God because he gave the best for me. I'm going to give to God because he gave his son for me. He gave his son. His son gave his life that you and I might have eternal life. Can I get a witness? You ought to get happy all by yourself when you think about how good God been to you, when you think about how far God brought you from, you think about what God saved you from, what God kept you from. Can I get a witness? Anybody know him? Say, yeah, yes, yes. I know the man. I know him from myself. I know it. Living by your giving. The only thing God asks for us the widow woman's story will not be the last story. You will have a story. If you'll put him first, somebody tell you, you don't have to wait till you get to church on Sunday. So let me tell you what it done for you. See, we want to come to church and tell us. But if you have been made a light, it's our responsibility to find some dark corner of life and tell somebody that's going through a famine situation how God brought you through, how God kept you in a famine. Remember, maybe somebody said, Pastor, I got plenty of food, but I'm running low on my faith. Y'all with me? Somebody said, I got freezers full of food, but I'm running low on my faith. Faith coming by hearing. She heard Elijah. Now, you know what I hollered? Because not only did she hear him, not only did she hear him, but she heeded. See, we can hear sermon after sermon in your private devotional time, your meditation. You can hear God speak to your spirit. But if you don't take the next step, he do it. She went to a house. She heard and she heeded. She headed home. Went to the kitchen. Took that little meal. Took that little oil. Made him some first. Watch this. And looked back over it with some more meal. And some more oil. Still a famine the next morning. She looked back over and some more meal and some more. Y'all, I'm going to catch you sooner or later. You're going to holler for yourself. You kept going through, but you look back over and some more meal and some more. And doctor said something crazy, but some more meal and some more. Your kids acting stone crazy. There's some more meal and some more. The economy going upside down, but more meal. More, you done went from 44 to 45 to 46. They keep changing, but more meal and more all. You done had Senate and Congress and all of them making decisions, but more meal and more all. I don't put my trust in the State House or the White House. The woman teaches us one principle. Trust God. Don't care who you are. Trust God. Elijah just happens to be the mouthpiece of the moment. That God uses him as a conduit to get his word through him to her. Trust God. Trust God. And conduits can take it one way or go back the other way. When she took care of Elijah's request, God took care of all, everybody say all of her needs. When she took care of what God said through the man God said, now I can give her my sources. Catch this. Your job is not your source. Your job is your resource. Your place of employment is your resource. Where you get your check is your resource. Where you get your supply is your resource. Your husband is your resource. Your wife is your resource. But your source is God and God alone. Don't ever get your check mixed up with what God did for me. I used to work for a company years ago. Brother Fletcher, I get paid on Friday night. He wouldn't pay us till after 8 o'clock. Because the building we worked in, the bank was open at 6. If we went to work at 5, if he'd have paid us at 5, we could have got our checks. He knew the money wasn't going to be there until the next week. Y'all miss me. So he had to pay us late so we couldn't get to the bank. God ain't Pickens, he said, I supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory. And he ain't run out of nothing. In fact, we govern our money by the gold that we have in the vaults. You know what they do with gold in heaven? They walk on it.
God, again, we thank you now for this time of fellowship and communion. Thank you that as we commune together, you will meet us at point of need. Because of your completed work at Calvary, we totally trust you. Do all things well. Forgive, heal, deliver, set free, give counsel in your presence and all of life. In Jesus' name we pray.